Thanks, comrades. The recent film called The Theory of Everything, in my view, excellent film, biopic of scientist Stephen Hawking, poses the question that I want to address today. It's popularised this idea of, is there a theory of everything? Hawking, or the character playing, actor playing Hawking in the movie, puts it very simply in one exchange, where he dreams and says, a single equation that would explain everything in the world, wouldn't that be beautiful? And that's a slight simplification, that's not actually what he means, a single equation, if we could be precise about it, but a theory, a set of equations in mathematical times taken as a whole, a coherent whole, which would do the job that he was talking about, which would unify and explain our understanding of the physical world. And in, that's one sense in which I want to address the question of a theory of everything. And it's usually when people talk about this, certainly within science, what they're talking about is a single theory which will explain the laws of physics, if you like, the physical world. So that's one sense I want to address it. There's another sense which is often associated with that, but it's not the same, and it's two distinct ideas, which is a different idea, which is that if you had such a theory about the laws of physics, then all other phenomena in nature can be explained by and reduced to and ultimately explained by that theory as well, whether it's chemistry, biology, and so on. And the two ideas are often connected, but they're actually distinct ideas. So one idea, a theory of everything, the one that Hawking's talking about, is some kind of theory which would explain all of the, what we know about the physical world. And a connected but slightly separate idea, can other areas of our understanding of the natural world then be explained by and reduced to, ultimately, that theory about the laws of physics? And I want to try and say a little bit about both of those ideas, and in doing so, raise some challenges and issues to the first one, about the theory of everything, about the laws of physics, and sharply disagree with the idea that everything else could be reduced to any such theory, even if such a one existed. And first I want to do that by sketching out a little bit of the history of some of these ideas, because I think if you look at the history, you can see some of the issues and problems about the ideas today. You can trace back the idea of a theory of everything quite far in the history of human ideas. At the risk of being slightly Eurocentric, and I'm aware of that because these ideas have been developed all over the world, I'll give one example. If you go back to the ancient Greek philosopher Democritus, one of the people who developed the theory that all matter was made up of atoms, not the atoms we understand, they have different size and shapes, but essentially an atomic theory, and that everything was explained by collisions between these different atoms, and that not only explained things physically, ultimately that explained everything in the world. That was a theory of everything in both senses, that the collisions between these atoms explained what happened in the physical world, and that everything else in the world ultimately could be reduced to and explained. So in that sense, that was a claim to be a universal theory of everything. That was not really a scientific theory, despite the name atomic theory. It wasn't very much to do with our modern atomic theory. It was a philosophical insight, but it gives you an idea what's meant by a theory of everything. I want to jump forward, however, just to save time, to the first attempt to develop what I call a scientific theory along these grounds, which comes with the scientific revolution of the 16th and 17th centuries, mainly because of what was happening in Europe at the time, associated with European figures like Copernicus in Poland, Johannes Kepler, Galileo Galilei in Italy, and Isaac Newton in Britain. It was an enormous revolution, that scientific revolution, in our understanding of the natural and physical world. I haven't got time to go into it here, but I just do want to say that it's important to understand that that revolution in science and ideas was intimately bound up and connected with changes in wider society at the time. You can't fully explain it without locating it in the development of capitalism, the way that was changing the structure of trade, the nature of production, and that was posing new questions, and that led to the development of new ideas. That's a whole separate meeting, but far too often, discussion about developments in scientific theory is discussed as though it's over here. It's something that takes place in a rarefied world of blackboards or computers and theoreticians, without locating it, that is ultimately rooted in and connected to wider social changes. It has a life of its own, the theoretical discussion, but it doesn't float free from what's happening in society. I'll come back briefly, but as I said, that's a whole separate discussion to have. So if I focus in this meeting on developments in ideas, I just want to put that as a caveat. I don't see these ideas as floating independent of what's happening in society, but time means I want to focus on the ideas today. So what? Let me take Newton as an example. What did Isaac Newton, what was it really about? What he took was our understanding of different aspects of what we understood about the world at the time, different partial explanations, and unified them. So we took what we knew about motion here on Earth, things like Galileo and people like that had developed. We also looked at the fact that Kepler and people had discovered that the planets moved on elliptical orbits, so what we knew about things happening up there in space, outside the Earth. But also other things like the fact that the tides that exist every day, which nobody had ever been able to explain properly. He took all of that and produced a unified theory which explained all those disparate phenomena on the basis, essentially, this is slightly crude, but it's not that much crude, of three simple laws plus a universal law of gravitation. In other words, a unified, coherent theory which claimed to explain all of those different phenomena. It wasn't quite the theory of everything, but it was a theory of quite a lot in terms of what had been done before. And it was an enormous advance in our understanding of the physical world, and it gave us the ability to then use that theory to go on and do other things and understand other aspects of the world. And it's the foundation of everything that came for the next 350 years, and actually is still very powerful today. It's one of the biggest breakthroughs in our scientific understanding of the world. Like anything, Newton wasn't the last word. His work had lots of issues and problems within it. God still had a little role to play in Newton's theory. It was important, not for philosophical reasons. There were certain things in the theory that required a prime mover, a godlike figure in any sense. But other scientists, Euler, Lagrange, and the person I want to quote in a second, Pierre Laplace, in France at the start of the 19th century, solved some of those problems, succeeded in removing God entirely from the equation. Just a little anecdote, when Napoleon, the emperor in France, said to Laplace, you've developed all these ideas on the basis of Newton and so on, where's God? Laplace's response was, I have no need of that hypothesis. In other words, he managed to create a scientific theory which was coherent, hung together, and successfully explained without the need to recourse to any idea of God, large chunks of our understanding about the physical world. And in Laplace's version of Newton's ideas, we come much closer to a claim to be a theory of everything. And see, in Laplace's notion, it was rigidly deterministic, and I want to explain what I mean by that, which is that if you knew what was happening now in the physical world, that would allow you to explain and predict everything about what was happening both in the future and in the past. I'll give a quote from Laplace, who spells it out quite clearly. He said, consider an intelligence which at any instant could have a knowledge of all the forces controlling nature, together with the momentary, i.e. what's happening now, conditions of all the entities of which nature consists, by which he means the particles and so on. If this intelligence were powerful enough to submit this data to analysis, it would be able to embrace in a single formula the movements of the largest bodies in the universe and those of the lightest atoms. For it, nothing would be uncertain. The future and the past would be equally present to its eyes. So that's a fairly bold claim to say, if you, of course there's a practical question, could you get that knowledge of what was happening to all the atoms and particles at the moment? There's a practical question, but as a philosophical claim, it's quite clear. If we did know that, we would know everything future and past. It would be a theory of everything, not just now, but a theory of everything forwards and backwards in time. So that was Laplace's claim on the culmination of the work that Newton. The only obstacle he saw was the practical one of getting enough information. In other words, our inability practically to get the information put limits on it, but there was no theoretical or philosophical limit to the claim. There's a few important characteristics of what I'll call the Newton-Laplace version of the world, which it's important to understand. Apologies if some of these sound slightly technical, but they do matter for the argument today. Firstly, I've said it was deterministic. It was, if you knew this, it was absolutely determined what was going to happen next. In other words, the equations told you from A, you know where, how you're going to get to B is a logical consequence of it. The future is determined. Secondly, it was time reversible. And by this, I don't mean some fantasy from Doctor Who or something like that. It meant that the laws he was talking about, it didn't matter whether time ran forwards or backwards. Now that might sound weird. What it means is that if you ran a movie of a world according to the laws of Newton and Laplace backwards in time, it would look fine. There's nothing in their understanding that says there's any difference between forwards and backwards in time. And that's really crucial for a reason that will become clear in a moment. There's another problem with time in both Newton and Laplace, actually, which Michael Faraday identified in the 19th century, which is time. Think gravity is supposed to act instantaneously at any distance. Now, if you think about it for a second, that's slightly problematic. It means that something close by, or something millions and billions of miles away, at an instant, has an effect anywhere else in the universe. So there's an issue there to do with time and things like that, and I'll come back to that later on. Third thing about it, as I've said, it was universal and reductionist. The claim was that if we understood this, if we could practically get this knowledge, it would explain everything. All levels of nature, all levels of our understanding of the world could be reduced to this single formula, as he put it. Let me be clear, having said that, one thing, the theory was true in the sense that it captured and explained really well important and real aspects of the world that we live in. It worked, to put it crudely. It wasn't silly. It was these equations, this science actually did explain the world and was incredibly powerful and successful. And without it, much of the scientific advance of the last few hundred years would have been completely impossible. But this is a point I want to make, and this is a general point. It's not my point. Actually, it's drawing on an argument put by Engels a long time ago. Like any scientific theory, what is a scientific theory? It's you look at some aspects of the world, in this case the physical world that we live in, on the basis of looking at those aspects of the physical world, you make abstractions and generalizations, form theoretical concepts, which you then try and create some set of ideas, which you then use to better understand the very reality that you've abstracted from them, and hopefully push that understanding further than it was in the beginning. And that's the general process of scientific theory. You abstract from the real world, form some set of ideas and theories, and that gives you a purchase and a power to better understand the very world that you've abstracted from. That's the very nature of what scientific theory is, I would argue. But equally, like all scientific theories, because its concepts and ideas have been abstracted from part of reality, if you then push the theories derived from them outside of that sphere into new areas of the world that beyond where that original abstraction was taken from, at some point they'll begin to break down and contradictions will arise. And I want to try and develop that. That sounds a bit abstract and philosophical. I want to illustrate it by telling the story of what's happened since and now, because I think that makes the process much more clear. And I think that's the problem when you come to talk about a theory of everything. It doesn't understand this process of abstraction, formulation of theories from partial aspects of reality, but then inevitably, as you push them into other areas of reality, they're going to break down and throw contradictions over. It's understanding that is the question mark over the idea of a theory of everything. So the first blow to that Laplacian-Newton worldview really came quite early in the 19th century with the emerging science of thermodynamics, the question of heat, absolutely linked to the development of the Industrial Revolution steam engines that posed the questions which this science then had to answer. Some of the figures involved, people like Sadie Carnot in France, Boltzmann, Gibbs, and then Maxwell in Britain, developed a whole set of ideas of science of thermodynamics. The science of thermodynamics, the theoretical ideas they came up with from studying processes of heat, are absolutely accurate and correct and reflect that view of reality. It's correct and good science, the science of thermodynamics. But it sits very, very uneasily, to put it mildly, with that Newtonian, Laplacian worldview I described earlier. Let me give you two examples of when I'll go further. It's actually quite contradictory in lots of ways. So you can have two correct theories which partially explain the world, which constantly clash and contradict or simply can't be reconciled. Let me give two examples. The question, thermodynamics is fundamentally irreversible in time. I'll try and list it as a simple example. Pour some cold milk into a cup of coffee and watch what happens. That's going forwards in time. And then try and unstir the milk from the cup of coffee. You can't do it. Processes involving heat are fundamentally irreversible. They can go one way but can't be reversed. Now that seems common sense when you talk about the real world, but when you're talking about theoretical explanations, the whole point of Laplace-Newton was that they were irreversible, the time could flow in either direction. Yet here we have another scientific theory, just as valid, which is fundamentally the opposite, which says there's a direction, it can only go in one direction. Put crudely, heat goes from hot to cold, not the other way around. And there's a whole theoretical set of ideas, the second law of thermodynamics and so on, derived from this. But you've got two theoretical edifices, both of which are correct and partially explain the world that we live in, but which have that deep contradiction involved in them. The second problem is, I said that Newton Laplace was essentially, some qualification, essentially a deterministic view. Except thermodynamics is essentially based upon chance statistics and probability. It's about the probabilities and statistical phenomena. So you've got a problem here as well. One scientific idea, which is rigidly deterministic, but an equal scientific now, which explains other parts of the world, which has chance and probability and statistics, is fundamentally built into it. But the two things don't sit very easily together. So what I'm arguing is that's an illustration of that general pattern, how you look at aspects of reality, abstract and create a theory which works, which gives you a purchase on reality, is true in that sense, is demonstrated to be true. But then when you can do the same from another part of reality, they don't always sit together. They can clash and throw up contradictions with each other. That's just one example. I would argue this is a process fundamentally built in to all our development of understanding of the natural world. Let me give another example from the 19th century. In the early 19th century, there were discoveries which meant that people began to see a connection between the long-known phenomena of magnetism, long-known but not well understood, and the new phenomena of electricity. And after lots of work, people began to connect these two things, and to cut a long story short, in the course of the 19th century, you get eventually James Maxwell in Scotland, actually, in Britain, who unified these with the whole theory about electromagnetism and his wave equations and so on. A brilliantly successful, really elegant theory, which successfully explained electricity and magnetism, and also, again, abstracting from that, set up a set of theoretical ideas, which not only explains that, but then also allows you to predict things you didn't know beforehand. Radio waves, X-rays, and things like that all arose out of that understanding. So when you theorise and create a theory, it doesn't just allow you to explain what you already know, it does explain that better than you previously did, but often it allows you to then push forward and predict and explain things you haven't already known. And electromagnetic theory is one of those areas. Virtually everything we use, most of the technology in this room wouldn't work without Maxwell and all of his ideas. So Maxwell's theories about electromagnetism were, again, true. They'd abstracted from that part of the natural world when you look at electricity and magnetism. A brilliant set of theoretical ideas which explained that allowed you to understand things you hadn't previously understood. Problem: Maxwell's theory and laws are fundamentally in contradiction to Newton and Laplace's laws. The two can't both be true at the same time. I'm not going to go into the techniques to do with frames of reference, whether the laws of physics are the same for any two observers moving relative to each other. But fundamentally, the two theories couldn't both be true at the same time. So you get yet another contradiction. So now, this is a simplification, but if you just look at the world of physics, you've got three different sets of ideas. Newton, Laplace, and their ideas about motion and so on. You've got thermodynamics, you've got electromagnetism, all of which in their own terms are good scientific theories, all of which give you real purchase onto reality, all of which allow you to predict and understand things you didn't previously understand and were well tested and tried. Fantastic. Except in different ways, all three of them absolutely contradict each other and can't be simultaneously true. What I'm arguing is this is a normal process for science. The idea that science is something where you discover a universal truth and that's it, is it makes a nonsense and a parody of the real process of scientific progress and the development of scientific ideas. And it was to move forward to the 20th century, it was how does scientific development take place? It was precisely out of attempts to reconcile these contradictions. People understood there was a contradiction. Everybody knew Maxwell and Newton, to put it crudely, couldn't both be true at the same time. And it was out of an attempt to look at that contradiction that a new scientific revolution took place in the first part of the 20th century. I'm talking in particular about the emergence of relativity theory and quantum theory, the two pillars of modern physics. It was Albert Einstein who first resolved one of the contradictions with what he called his special theory of relativity, the one everybody's heard about with E equals mc squared and all that kind of thing. But what that really did was take Maxwell's equations for electromagnetism and Newton's laws and went beyond both to create a new theory, special relativity, out of which came E equals mc squared, which went beyond both and showed why the contradiction had arisen by creating a new theory. But it's important to understand it wasn't just a simple reconciliation of the two previous theories, it was a completely new understanding which showed why the contradiction had existed between the two. And special relativity is a slightly bizarre theory, but it's been one of the most verified and tested theories in the history of science. It works, it's true in that sense. It says strange things that don't make common sense. It says that the speed of light is an absolute maximum. And it doesn't matter how fast you're moving, if you measure the speed of light, you will always get the same answer. Now that seems to contradict common sense. If I measure somebody walking along there and I'm standing still, they look to be moving so fast. If I'm on a train hurtling in that direction, they look to be moving very fast in that direction. The speed looks different if I'm moving. That's actually not true when you measure the speed of light. It doesn't matter how fast I'm moving at all. When I measure the speed of light, I get exactly the same answer whether I'm standing still or whether I'm travelling at half the speed of light. It seems to contradict common sense, but it's been well tested and verified. A consequence of that is also some strange things which science fiction filmmakers and writers love, that moving clocks go slow. So the idea, which you'll have seen in lots of films, if some astronaut flies off around the universe somewhere and they have a twin on Earth, they'll come back, they won't be the same age because time's run at a different, slower rate for the person travelling fast out there than the person who's to near. But again, all of these phenomena have been well tested and tried. They're real, they're not fantasies or anything. So that was one breakthrough, but it created that entirely new theory. Einstein then went on to create an even more revolutionary theory, which, because up to that point, the question of gravity hadn't been addressed. And Einstein then addressed the question of how do you reconcile gravity into the picture with, it, speaking as a mathematician, I think by far the most beautiful theory ever created in the history of science, which is Einstein's theory of general relativity. The mathematics and the thing is absolutely fantastic. But what it really does is it takes the idea of, it says that the very geometry of space-time, because in Einstein's understanding space and time are intimately connected, it's not something fixed, it's not just a passive backcloth against which things move. The very geometry of the space and time that we live in is determined and shaped by the distribution of mass, and it's then the geometry of the space and time that determines how that mass moves. That explains things like gravity and so on. It's a radically new and different theory and understanding, but again, it's one that has been tested and proven over and over again. It doesn't just explain exotic phenomena like black holes and so on, although it does do that. It explains some things that hadn't been understood before, but till that point, nobody had even been able to accurately explain the orbit of Mercury around the Sun, because the gravitational effects, because it's quite close to the Sun, are important. And all of Newton and everybody like that had never been able to accurately explain it. Einstein's theory allows you to do that, so it was well tested and proven. So Einstein, if you like, took that question, the question of gravity, motion, Maxwell, and reconciled them in two theories of relativity. But the revolution wasn't over, because there was still another problem. And the problem was as simple as this, that on all of that understanding, atoms, every atom in the world, shouldn't exist. Even when allowing for relativity, every atom should collapse in a burst of radiation virtually instantaneously. That was a big problem, because that clearly didn't happen. And it was out of that understanding that what quantum mechanics became, first quantum theory and then quantum mechanics, which really looked at the idea that energy can't just exist in any old quantity, but it's packaged up in discrete packets, quanta, which is the word for packets. That was fundamental to our understanding. And that led on to a whole new understanding, which, again, has lots of quantum mechanics, which have lots of seemingly bizarre things. But, again, quantum mechanics is probably the most accurate and best-tested theory in the whole history of science. That camera, my mobile phone, that air conditioning system, any computer in the world, none of them would work unless the predictions of quantum mechanics were absolute. The air conditioning might not be working that well. But none of them would work with, they're supposed to at all, were it not for quantum mechanics. And quantum mechanics is a really bizarre theory. Because what it says is that, well, things can sometimes be particles, they can be waves, they can be a bit of both at the same time, that there's no clear distinction between whether something's a wave or a particle. It depends how you look at it. That seems really odd and strange, but again, it's been verified over and over and over again. It also says that the world is fundamentally, not because of our ignorance, but it's fundamentally based upon chance and probability. The very things that quantum mechanics talks about, the wave function that's at the heart of it, is a probability wave. It simply tells you the probability of something being in a particular place at any one time. You can't see, it's not about describing something will be there. All I can say is I can show you the probability of it being here, there, and everything, and various other places. You know, and again, that seems odd and weird. It's important to understand that that randomness, that probability, isn't as a result, as it was for Laplace, a result of our ignorance. It's fundamentally built into the natural world. In other words, it's saying that the world is inherently based upon probability and so on. And that's quite a weird understanding. It's also got an inherent uncertainty, and again, not one based on ignorance. It says, for example, this is the famous Heisenberg uncertainty principle, that you can know the position of something exactly, but if you do that, you can't know the velocity, essentially. And the more accurately you know the velocity, the less accurately you're going to know the time. You can't simultaneously nor the position and velocity of any object at all. And they say that's not because of ignorance, it's not because we're not clever enough to work this out. They say this is built into the natural world, that uncertainty. And it's not just position and time, there's a whole set of other things that go with it. But that, I say that strangeness has been confirmed over and over again, and lots of the things we take for granted in the world. Every time you turn your computer on, you're relying on that theory for it to work, assuming it works properly. So it's a powerfully confirmed theory. So now, surely, the 20th century, we've had these new theories, this new revolution, which resolved those earlier contradictions I talked about. Surely now we're well on the way to having a theory of everything. We've had relativity, special relativity, general relativity, resolved those earlier contradictions. We've got quantum mechanics, which has got rid of some of the other problems. Surely now we're well on the way, except not at all. Because the fundamental problem is even worse, that general relativity and quantum mechanics are absolutely and utterly incompatible and contradictory in just the sharp sense as any of the theories in the 19th century were. There have been some steps forward. So you can combine special relativity with quantum mechanics. That has been done. The problem is gravity. You can't do that at all. And there have been lots of understandings and developments which have combined other forces. I'm not going to go into details here, but things like quantum electron, the weak force that controls decay, beta decay in atoms, that's been integrated, and our understanding of the strong force inside atoms in something called quantum prodynamics, and people might have seen more recently a whole understanding of the fundamental particles, what's called the standard model, and most people have come across in the newspapers something called the Higgs boson, which was supposedly discovered quite recently, begins to make a lot of sense of what's happening in that physical world to do with atoms and particles and so on. None of that has removed the absolute fundamental contradiction between all of that understanding and gravity, if you like, general relativity. The two things are utterly incompatible. Again, I don't want to go into a physics lecture, but I'll just give some hint of what the problem is. If you like, in quantum mechanics, all of it takes place again a background of a space in which the geometry is fixed. You know, all these things are moving around, and there's a fixed geometry out there in terms of how, you know, the normal geometry that we take for granted here. You know, angles in a triangle add up to 180 degrees, and all those kind of things. General relativity says the exact opposite. It says actually there is no fixed geometry. The distribution of mass changes the geometry in radical ways so that the angles in a triangle don't add up to 180 degrees, for example. They might be more, they might be less, depending on what happens. But it's a radically different picture. One, the space and time against which these events unfold is a fixed backcloth. The other one, no, it's not as dynamically interrelated to the changes as the distribution of mass changes. It's quite a big fundamental contradiction. The other problem is that in quantum mechanics, time is simply a parameter. It just flows along, blah, blah, blah. Nothing doesn't change, anything like that. That's radically different in relativity. You know, that time is actually integrated with space. There is no such thing as space and time. There's a thing called space-time, and you can't separate time off in the way that in quantum mechanics, time is just a single, just a line along which everything operates. There's another problem, and this is, I promise this is the very last bit of technical mathematics. Quantum mechanics is what's called a linear theory. What that really means is that the sum is just, the whole is just the sum of the parts. If you understand this, 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 and this, you just add them all together, that will explain everything. General relativity is completely and utterly non-linear. Where it says that you can't, you know, putting the parts together doesn't, on its own, a simple aggregate of the parts doesn't give you the total explanation. That the totality behaves in different ways because the parts are interrelated and affect each other. And so, in all those different ways, the twin pillars of modern physics are utterly contradictory. And there's been lots of work done on that. In the film Theory of Everything, that's exactly what Stephen Hawking is working on, trying to reconcile those two things. Yet despite now nearly 100 years of efforts, nobody has succeeded. There are various ideas around, some of them bizarre, but we have to be open to bizarre ideas. I'll mention one, string theory, which tries to reconcile these by saying actually the world is made up, some people say 10, some people say 11 dimensions, but most of them are rolled up and so small you can't see them, and all we see is the normal world of four dimensions, three of space and one in time. But none of this is well proven or well tested. Whether any of these ideas turn out to be well founded, we'll have to wait and see. But the point is, nobody has yet reconciled it. So the twin pillars of modern physics are contradictory, and that hasn't successfully been resolved. So in that sense, there is not a theory of everything, I guess even if they succeed at some point in reconciling these twin pillars of modern physics by going beyond them to some new theory, because that's what it will require, does that mean that then will be a theory of everything? I think the whole history I've tried to sketch shows that that's unlikely. That theory too, when pushed beyond the limits of what we know, is likely to run into new contradictions or run into clashes with other parts of our understanding of nature, which throw up contradictions, and that will require further change and development. So I would argue that the dynamic of the development of scientific ideas puts a question mark over whether the very idea that you can arrive at some ultimate theory which will explain once and for all time the laws of physics, and that will be an end of matter, I think that's not borne out if you look at the historical development of scientific ideas, that this process of abstraction and theorization, which gives us a real understanding of nature, but that those break down and come into contradiction with other understandings of nature beyond certain limits, and it's out of those contradictions that then new ideas are forced to be developed, that this is an inherent part of the process of everything. And it's an understanding of that, not some chasing after the holy grail of a theory of everything, that we should be focusing on if we really want to understand what's going on. The final thing I'll say is that's one aspect of an idea of a theory of everything. There's another aspect which to me is very exciting and interesting. I mentioned earlier on about thermodynamics, which is quite all sorts of contradictions with many existing theories. And in recent years, the last few decades, I'll mention one scientist, Ilya Prigogine in Belgium, began looking at an understanding of the thermodynamics, heat, processes involving heat, that when it's open, when they're interacting with other things. Well, actually, that's most things in the world, if you think about it. The idea that you can separate something off from the world and it doesn't interact with the rest of the world is an abstraction. In reality, everything in the world interacts and exchanges with things outside. So when Prigogine talks about that thermodynamic process as far from equilibrium, he's actually talking about most of reality. And out of that work and lots of other work, an understanding of what's sometimes called complexity theory, has got lots of other descriptions as well, has begun to be developed in recent years. And for me, that's quite exciting, because what that begins to show is that if you've got an understanding at one level of nature, you can't reduce everything that happens at more complex levels of nature to that understanding. I want to give two illustrative, I stress they're only illustrative examples. You can know everything you like about the properties of hydrogen, and people who do quantum mechanics know this. They can predict down to 10 million decimal places how a hydrogen atom is going to behave. The same for oxygen. You put two hydrogen atoms and an oxygen atom together, you get something called H2O. And most of you know that's the thing in this bottle here. Now, it doesn't matter how much you understand about the quantum dynamics of hydrogen and oxygen, that on its own is not enough to explain how fluids like water move and the dynamics of the fluid flow. In other words, once you get a complexity, you get what are called emergent properties. It can't be in contradiction to the underlying system. Nothing that water does when it's flowing as a liquid can contradict the understanding of how hydrogen atoms behave or oxygen atoms behave, but you can't reduce an explanation of how water flows and turbulence and things like that, reduce it down to simply an understanding based upon the behavior of hydrogen atoms and oxygen atoms. It has to be compatible, it can't be direct contradiction, but it isn't sufficient to understand the underlying things. You have to understand it at that level of fluid flow as well. Another simple example, just for illustrative purposes, if you start heating water, or any liquid for that matter, at first it just rises, there's all sorts of strange things going on. At a certain point, under certain conditions, suddenly it can switch into large-scale motions, things called Bernard cells, hexagonal convectional cells. And even understanding all the things you like about water and things like that won't explain why that happens. You have to have a different level of understanding. So the point I'm getting at is there's the beginnings of an understanding in modern science about how you get what are called emergent properties as a result of complexity. What that really means is that the laws of chemistry, for example, of course they can't contradict the underlying laws of physics about atoms and things like that, but nor are they reducible to that. Things happen at the chemical level that have to be understood and explained at that level, not simply reduced down to the laws of physics. Even more so when you get more complex levels of nature, biology for example, whether it's at the level of genes and things like that, organisms, evolution, species and things like that, that of course none of that can be, or a human being, a human body can't exist in contradiction to the laws of physics. That's, you take that as read. But does that mean you can reduce an understanding of human biology or evolution to an understanding of the laws of physics? Not at all. There are emergent properties, laws of biology, laws of evolution, which we have to grasp and understand at that level, which are not in contradiction to the underlying laws of physics, but you need to, they're emergent and they need to have their own explanation at that level. And I think that's a very powerful insight of something that people argued long ago, but now modern science is beginning to show concretely and specific, not in a hand-waving way. It's not good enough to say, oh, there's the laws of physics, and then there's these other laws of biology. What's exciting now is people are beginning to understand how that process of emergence takes place, how it is that when you reach certain levels of complexity, to understand the very process by which that gives rise to new ways of behaving, which are not reducible to the levels of behavior that you've seen at lower levels. And for me, that's a fantastically exciting development in science. And I think that begins to demonstrate why that idea of a theory of everything, that, you know, one, so there'll come some point in the future where we'll have some theory of everything for the laws of physics, and in principle, everything else about what we understand about nature could be reduced to that, is actually not only a fantasy, it's non-scientific in terms of what we're beginning to understand about the world today, and that notion of emergent properties as a result of complexity requiring to laws and to be understood at their own level as well. So on both those counts, I think the idea of a theory of everything, however attractive it might be to some people, in both of its senses, is a questionable idea. I don't believe in this idea, if you look at the history of physics, that we'll have a theory of everything which will be the final word and will explain the entire workings of the laws of physics. I think at some point it will break down and the new contradictions will be thrown up. We haven't even solved the existing ones yet. But nor do I think it's scientifically valid the idea that whatever theory you have about physics, understanding of different levels of nature can be collapsed down and reduced to those. There are emergent properties because of complexity which require an understanding at that level and a beginnings of an understanding of how those different levels of explanation are related and connected to each other is one of the most exciting developments in modern science. So I'll stop there.
Yeah, I'm John Pynton from Oxford. I wanted to sort of talk a bit about this issue of... This issue of whether we can reduce everything to physics, including biology. Now, as a biologist, I guess I've got an interest in whether this is really possible or not. And I think it is an illusion. I think it's part of the whole reductionist way of looking at the world that is actually very characteristic of capitalism, and it affects science to a large extent as well. And I think it's an illusion because, as Paul's exactly said, things, as objects get more complex, they take on new properties, and we really have to understand those new properties, not think we can reduce things. And yet there have been people who've, in biology, have tried to do that. It was actually Francis Crick, who was the co-discoverer of the double helix DNA structure, and also has come up with some interesting ideas about the brain, consciousness, who once said that biology should try and reduce everything to chemistry and ultimately physics. And I think it is wrong in that, because it forgets the fact that something like the brain, its structure, the way the nerve cells are connected together, has a huge impact actually on the way that consciousness then develops within that. And especially because we're talking about human consciousness, we can't exclude the fact that we are social beings, and that plays an incredibly important role in the development of consciousness, both in our evolution and the way it develops as we develop it in a society as we grow up. And in fact, you can see attempts to try and reduce consciousness to things like quantum mechanics. Roger Penrose, one person who's tried to do this. I think Jim Al-Khalili is it, who's trying now to use this new quantum biology to explain consciousness. It simply, I don't think, works for me. I mean, it's not that you can't have insights into consciousness from quantum mechanical principles, but I think it neglects this extra complexity the brain has, which is often, I think physicists can often be a bit naive about the true complexity of the brain. I mean, Stephen Hawking, for all his brilliant insights into physics, recently has said that the biggest threat to mankind, humankind at the moment, is artificial intelligence. Computers are going to think like people, they're going to take over the world, that kind of thing. Now, maybe I'll eat my words if I see a Terminator-like figure and it's not coming to take me out in the next 10 years or so, but I think it's unlikely that's going to happen, because I think that misinterprets the difference between a human brain and a computer. There really is a huge difference there. Now, one of the things I actually find quite interesting in the sense of the way we can use physics and biology to really take our understanding forward is the fact that new technologies in physics are having a huge impact on our understanding of the brain. So optogenetics, ability to engineer the brain so it can respond to light, so you can pinpoint specific parts of the brain and trigger specific impulses, and you can have effects on behaviour. That's all happening. There's even now a technology to be able to turn on genes from distance by electromagnetic waves. I mean, this is great. It could also be misused. I mean, they now can take mice, make them forget things they remembered, or they can make them remember things they've never... I'll swine up, yeah. They've never seen before. So obviously it could be misused, but I think it's got fantastic potential for medicine as well. I understand it's great.
It's ironic that this meeting clashes with a meeting on the importance of Hegel, because Hegel thought he had a theory of everything. But he worked that out purely by thinking about it, not by doing empirical science. But maybe what he said about being nothing and becoming might in some way connect with ideas of quantum fluctuation and virtual particles. Can I ask Paul this question? If there were to be a theory of everything, would it have to have these four characteristics? It would be a single mathematical formula or equation. It would describe the most basic properties of the most basic entities, whatever those are. It would unify the four forces of nature. And it would be possible to deduce the laws of the familiar laws of physics and chemistry directly from it. But it would not be possible to deduce history from it. So it would still not explain everything. Just a couple of other points. Lenin argued against a theory of everything. He said that the dialectic goes on forever. There will always be more to be discovered. Dialectical materialism is not reductionist. You know, and that goes back to Hegel, who said that changes of quantity become changes of quality. On the question of consciousness, I think that if scientists can describe the process by which consciousness arose, they will have explained consciousness. But they will not have defined consciousness, because there is an irreducible qualitative difference between states of being that are conscious and states of being that are unconscious. So I think consciousness can be explained but not defined. Thanks.
I think for me the central contradiction of science under capitalism is that it's simultaneously the most productive and destructive social system devised yet. So we live in a very productive society with increased life expectancy, antibiotics, airplanes, the internet and so on, yet we also live in a very destructive one with endless war, nuclear weapons and global warming. But I think a couple of contemporary trends at the moment we need to talk about is the commodification of the data of individuals, say, on the internet. So in the West, for example, we can see this through in privacy debates on the internet. Say, Google and Apple offer very productive apps, yet on the other hand, they track all your internet usage, copy all your contacts and target adverts at you. And in Africa, for example, Facebook is offering free internet access, but only if you do everything through Facebook. If you also take other examples such as social media, such as Facebook and Twitter, in 2011 in Egypt, activists could send images of the revolution and gain international solidarity. That's fantastic. Yet yesterday, one of the revolutionary socialists in Egypt says that currently under the military dictatorship, they're monitoring everyone's Facebook usage. So, for example, if you disagree with the military that 30 people were on a demonstration and the military says it was 28, you'll be arrested and go to prison. But this is also taking place within science as well. So I think genetic engineering offers some interesting questions. So John Parrington's meeting yesterday said that the Human Genome Project, scientists that are working on that say it offers the possibility for personalised medicine. So your genome is sequenced and then they could devise medications to give you fewer side effects. However, the big question this raises is who's going to have access to that data? Will employers be able to access it to be able to deny workers jobs? How easy is it to get life insurance? So I think in conclusion for me, science itself is neutral. The real question is which class is going to benefit from the application of science. So for example, in Egypt, will activists benefit through the internet and social media, or will the ruling class from military state surveillance? Will corporations benefit from sequencing the human genome, or workers? And these questions will only be resolved by class struggle and workers fighting internationally to apply science for the benefit of people and not for profit.
Exactly.
I've got a question as well for Paul, and it's to do with the physical reality of the infinity. I mean, I think you gave a brilliant presentation there for the whole history of science, and the conclusion that you drew, a bit boring as a Trotskyist to say I actually agree with your conclusion there, that it is a progress that goes on all the time and never ends. But there is the issue, isn't there, of the physical reality of infinity. Mathematicians deal with infinity quite easily. But physicists not quite so easily. And for example, it's often written that black holes, material that goes into a black hole goes to an infinite density. Well, that's actually not true, and I think it's more and more acknowledged that that's not correct. And of course, there's also the issue, the old childhood question of what happened before the beginning of the universe. We're actually getting to the point, aren't we, of microseconds, nanoseconds almost, to the origin of the universe. But we can't actually get there because quantities start expanding towards infinity. And I wondered if you care to comment on how physicists should deal with the issue of the physical reality of infinity, just in 30 seconds.
Thank you for the presentation. In response to what this gentleman said, the whole idea of, we're dealing with what reductionism, basically, how science has been misused for reductionist purposes. You probably heard of Bertrand Russell, A.N. Whitehead, wrote a paper about how to reduce mathematics to finite axiomatic principles. My hero, Kurt Gödel, demolished that in 1931 with the incompleteness theorem. Right? For example, he proved, and it's not been disproved today, I don't think it'll ever be proved, humbly speaking, that the definition of a geometric properties cannot prove or disprove of its axiomatic system, whereby if you have an equilateral triangle, you can't prove or disprove it whether it's an equilateral triangle because they're axioms. And then in his second proof, he said that a mathematical system cannot prove its consistency. For example, simple arithmetical operations like you do in primary school, you can't use addition, the framework of an addition to subtract. They're all limited. So Kurt Gödel proved it in 31. Thank you.
You finally, at the end of your speech, you said you didn't think there'd be a theory of everything. I tend to disagree. The reason being that I believe the universe is infinite. If it's not infinite, if it's not infinite, it's got a boundary, and therefore there's something outside it. So the universe has to be infinite. If it has to be infinite, it has to have the totality of all knowledge. In other words, there is a theory of everything. It just be a matter of time before it's discovered. We just got to wait. You know, don't have. It might not even be before the human race is obliterated in 10 billion years' time. But nevertheless, it exists. And when we find it, I think that will explain why, for example, terminators will never exist. It will explain the theory of everything. Will explain that human consciousness cannot be reproduced electronically with dead inert material. And secondly, when it's discovered, it will explain in general and in particular, in general why revolutionary socialism and in particular the SWP will never gain political power.
I want to ask a couple of ask a question about empiricism. Ask a question about empiricism, which is basically the underlying process of scientific investigation. We treat it as objective and the only way of finding knowledge, but to what extent do we really know for sure that it isn't just a product of how our brains, how our minds understand things, how we've evolved? Can we really be sure that it's the only way to get knowledge? Not a very popular position to take among scientists, I think, but anyway. And also, just on the subject of reductionism, I'm not a reductionist, but I'm not entirely sure about the method you use to disprove reductionism. It seems to me that emergent properties can be predicted by, the lower level, but it's just so very complex that it's not practical to try and work from that level. When you have the other level, which doesn't require massive amounts of processing power to predict them. Okay, thanks.
Do you have a question?
I think there's something. I was going to make that point myself, actually, saying that you could. It is difficult to predict on using the lower level. Rather than higher level, you could predict how a computer play by just looking at the range of transistors in it and what computer software you had on it. But also, I wanted to point out that the fact that the universe doesn't have an edge doesn't mean it's infinite. It's just like the world. You could keep going around the world without finding the end of the world. It's just the universe could be just like that, just on three dimensions.
Exactly. A couple of people mentioned dialectics, and I want to say a little bit more about that, because it's quite an important part of this picture. But I want to start with the sort of mechanical materialism that Laplace and Newton talked about, because there's a sort of illusion that's quite common among scientists, certainly common to me when I first studied science, which is that the kind of empiricist, mechanical understanding of the universe is some kind of neutral frame of reference that's impartial and is the only starting point for really doing science. Whereas, in fact, what Marxism reveals is the way that this understanding of the universe itself has a history. And it emerges at a point in history, precisely when people thought in terms of isolated individuals beginning to meet on the market, and reflects the emergence of the early capitalist system. And in a sense, Newton's project, although it's a breakthrough in terms of the materialism of it, has all the shortcomings that reflect the kind of society it's born out of. Lenin says somewhere, I think, that intelligent idealism is better than mechanical materialism. And what he's pointing to there is the great insights of people like Hegel, who develops a much richer understanding of reality that emphasizes that you have to understand it's a totality, that it's full of contradictions, and these contradictions drive change. And the kind of things Paul was talking about, the different layers of reality, the different levels at which you understand it, and so on. There's problems with Hegel. He starts from ideas, the absolute idea, God, and so on and so forth, but it's a very rich starting point if you want to understand the universe. Part of what Marx and Engels do is they take this legacy of Hegel, stand it on its head, and try and apply it to the material world. This is why you have such brilliant insights in Engels' writings on natural science, which actually repay, I'm not saying he got everything right, but they're brilliant to read, brilliant insights in them. Does that mean that in order to do science you have to be a Marxist? Absolutely not. Does it mean that you just come along to science and say, you're stupid, you don't understand a dialectic, you don't understand anything about science? Absolutely not. But what it means is that as science has developed, the very process of trying to understand the material world often pushes scientists towards a more dialectic understanding of reality. And out of those kind of processes, whether they call it dialectics or not, you begin to get new developments like thermodynamics, quantum mechanics, and so on. One just final thing to conclude on. It's still true today that there are people who work at least partially within a mechanical materialist framework. One of the problems with that is it so easily flips over into crude idealism. Take the work of Richard Dawkins. In many ways, a very great scientist, but actually his crude determinism when it comes to genetics is combined with an understanding of religion, for example, that's pure idealism. Why are there so many wars and so much horror in the world? Because people have stupid religious ideas in their head. No understanding of the material reality that produces both these ideas and the horrors that people confront. We have to reject mechanical materialism, and we have to look to a more dialectical understanding of reality if we want to understand it and change it.
Okay, you mainly brought the biologist who was saying about artificial intelligence. I don't think artificial intelligence will ever take over. It might get programmed to a very high level of sophistication, but there'll be a couple of problems. First will be Gödel's incompleteness theorem will affect the way that you can program artificial intelligence. And second, artificial intelligence is generally specific. It doesn't deal with general things like the human brain has to deal with things like walking, talking, coordination, fight and flight. Artificial intelligence will never, unless you can program for it, it will never have emotion or the human drive that drives us. That's what makes us different from artificial intelligence. Also, the other thing I have is just a question. Can Heisenberg's uncertainty principle be analogous to Gödel's incompleteness theorem? Thank you.
Yeah, just a quick question, really. I mean, we've heard all the contradictions in science and how there's so much we don't know and can't explain. And you know, that brings to mind things like dark energy and dark matter. There's 70%, 80% of the energy and the matter in the universe. We don't know what it is. So the question is, are we just too stupid? Do we actually have the intelligence to ever explain these things?
I was just wondering, was it just all men coming up to ask questions? I was going to query about controlled chance. I want to get away from the notion of chance as being, is it statistical, is it randomness? or is it probabilities, okay? And let's say chance opens up something within a system that could be fixed or determined. Now, I'm not sure if this is dialectical. I suppose there has to be some kind of interplay between the two. But the question, the notion I want to ask is this. Was it accidental that Marx's PhD thesis was on Democritus? Or was it Democritus? And I've been looking at the I Ching to understand some kind of like principles of action and creation. And I was wondering, the question, just to cut it short, the question I want to ask is that, is there some kind of like a universality or commonness between several, shall we say, ancient systems of thought of the world cultures here that we can tap into in parallel with the historical materialism here?
I mean, yeah. Just a really quick question you mentioned at the end about the exciting work about explaining emergent properties. I wonder if you could just maybe talk a little bit more about that, or at least kind of point us in the direction of where to, you know, find out a bit more about that.
I'll try and deal with some of the questions, but apologies if I don't do all of them in the time available. But the comrade who talked about the significance of the work in logic of Kurt Gödel in the 1930s is quite right. Without going into the technical details, it's important to understand what the significance of what Gödel did was. That comrade referred to people like Russell. There was a whole philosophical school of people who really had that reductionist model that you could, first of all, you could have a simple set of axioms, basic facts, from which you could then derive and prove, first of all, the laws of mathematics. But really implied in that was that process could then continue just by a process of logical work. You could then construct a knowledge of the whole of reality. I slightly oversimplify and caricature, but essentially that's at the core of it. And what Gödel did was he said, okay, let's look at the first part of that argument, that we can simply show that mathematics itself, if you like, the laws of arithmetic that you all learn in school, are internally consistent, that you can prove beyond any doubt, just by logic, that there isn't a contradiction in the laws of arithmetic. That was the key problem that Gödel looked at. And what he didn't just demonstrate, he proved the exact opposite, that it's impossible to do that within the laws of arithmetic. And it was an earth-shattering blow at that whole philosophical project, which said that we can first of all, you know, start by logic, we can construct mathematics, and then go beyond. He showed you couldn't even take the first step, basically. So that's absolutely important. Actually, it's interesting, Stephen Hawking, despite what's portrayed in the film, does not any longer believe in the idea of a theory of everything, and he cites the reason why Gödel's incompleteness theorem, because he says if we can't even be sure about mathematics, we can't prove is internally consistent, how can we then expect to do everything else? So the comrade is quite right, it's a very important bit of work, and it has big philosophical implications. Does it have anything? I don't think that has very much to do with Heisenberg's uncertainty principle, comrade asked at the end. Now, Heisenberg's uncertainty principle, it takes the laws of mathematics completely for granted. Well, the technical details, it's a system of operators in linear algebra, and what it shows is that you can't simultaneously determine one operator and its conjugate partner at the same time. So it derives from within the laws of mathematics, taking them completely for granted, but it says there's still nevertheless an uncertainty when we apply this mathematics to the real world. And it's not just position and momentum, actually, but velocity will do for the purpose of this discussion. It says there's a fundamental thing not to do with our ignorance. It says it's on principle impossible to know precisely, derived from the mathematics. It takes this completely for granted. It's not challenging the foundations of mathematics at all. It's impossible in principle, and you can mathematically demonstrate this, to know where something is and how fast it's moving at the same time. It equally says it's impossible to know the energy and time at the same time, which is somebody mentioned, Perry, which is, well, lots of strange things happen in physics, that you can have out of nothing, out of the vacuum, popping into existence particles and antiparticles, as long as they don't exist for very long. In other words, the vacuum isn't really a vacuum, it's a bubbling form of things going in and out of existence all the time. And that sounds like fantasy, but it's rigorously mathematical and physically determined and been verified by experiment. So the vacuum creates pressure and so on. So these things are not science fiction, no, they are real. It might be strange, but they are very, very real phenomena. Another comrade asked about empiricism, and it really was a question about what's called epistemology, the theory of knowledge. How do we know that the things we find out about the world are not simply a product of our brains, but tell us something real about the world? Well, firstly, they are a product of our brains. You know, we create these theories and we do them. But the point is, a good place to start with this discussion, in the time of what I'll just refer to it, is what Marx said. I think Joseph will correct me if I'm wrong, the second thesis on Feuerbach. He was challenging another philosopher called Feuerbach, and he wrote a whole series of theses which took up some philosophical arguments, and that was one of the questions that was asked. And what Marx said is that the question of the truth or non-truth of human thinking is fundamentally a practical question. And I think I quoted correctly, mankind must demonstrate and prove in practice the correctness of his thinking. In other words, we can have these ideas. What determines truth is when we show in practice that this allows us, gives us purchase on the world that we're operating in. You have to demonstrate and show it in practice. That's not the whole discussion, but I think that's a very good starting point, that idea of Marx, is that you can have any ideas you like. The human brain can produce all sorts of ideas. The question of are they correct ideas is the one for being tested in practice. And actually, I'd argue that's not just a principle that's true for natural science. It's true at every level of understanding. If I assert something about history or society, is it true or not true? Well, I have to test it in practice. That's always the case. So I think that's the starting point. We have to show these things give us real understanding of the world. They allow us to do something in the world that we wouldn't otherwise be able to do. Right, so now I'm going to get lost in technical things here. Is the universe infinite? The fact that this question of boundaries, if anybody gets the chance to read Stephen Hawking's book, A Brief History of Time, that's what the book's about, basically. It's not true that if there's a boundary, things have to have a beginning, an end, and an outside. Let me give an analogy. Let's suppose you're confined on the surface of a balloon and the only reality you can perceive is on that surface. Is there a beginning and end to that? Yeah. If you go outside of those dimensions, you can see it's a surface embedded in three dimensions. If your entire reality is on the existence of that surface, there is no beginning and end. And at a more sophisticated level, what scientists have shown is that the question of a beginning of time, an end of time, people said, is there something before the Big Bang? The question of boundaries of space and time is not a simple question. It's outside of our realm of common sense. So what Hawking argues in that book, and I think probably correctly, that if certain scientific theories are correct, then the question of a beginning of time is not a valid question. You can't even ask that question. Built into lots of understandings of modern science, this is quite fundamental. The idea of a simple one, if I'm here, if something isn't infinite, then there must stop and there must be something else outside. It doesn't quite work like that. And I say that challenges common sense, but it's actually very central to lots of scientific understanding. We have the Engels warned in a very funny passage where he says about this idea of common sense applying to things. You know, good old common sense works because it's based upon our experience here. But if good old common sense goes wandering off to the edge of the universe and round black holes, he's going to get into lots of troubles, because our ideas and understanding are based upon an abstraction from what we see here, don't necessarily apply in those circumstances. So people, you can read more about that, but it's not as simple as you might think. Don't abstract from what you see when you're walking around this room and assume that's going to apply when you look at the large-scale structure of the universe. And so we have to find ideas which correctly explain that. It's not as simple as all that. This similar question about infinity. I mean, I'm a mathematician. I have no problem at all dealing with infinity, and I absolutely love the mathematics that Georg Cantor and people developed about the mathematics of the infinite. The question about infinite quantities in nature is a different question. All you can say, the truth is, we don't know. All you can say, for example, about black holes is that in the equations there's a singularity. In other words, you end up dividing by zero, and things get very, very big. Exactly. That's why it's called a singularity, because it comes out of this, the mathematics is based upon the idea you can have things at a single point. but when you reduce down to a single point, you find in the equation you're starting to get close to dividing by zero and all sorts of weird things happening. That's what the mathematics says. What that means physically, actually nobody really knows. That's the truth of it. What happens inside a black hole, nobody actually knows. Science fiction writers, if you ever saw that Interstellar recently, had all sorts of strange ideas about what happens. We don't know. Is the truth. We can know that a black hole can exist. We know that the gravity is so powerful nothing can escape from it, with the exception of Hawking radiation, which Stephen Hawking talks about in the film. But what happens inside at the so-called singularity, we don't know. What happened at the beginning of the universe, if you want to use that language, if you wind the clock back, again, we don't know. And a question about, well, does even the question make sense? Can time go back to zero? Does the question of having a zero for time even make sense? We don't know these questions. So there's a difference between the mathematical formalism you can have, and you cannot deal with infinite quantities, and what happens in the real world. Remember, the mathematics is a tool which allows us to try and explain nature. It's not the same as nature. We have to test our models against the real world. The last point I want to make is probably an important one. I absolutely disagree with this idea that several people raised, that it's only our ignorance, computing power, that surely we can predict all these things if we had enough computing and enough knowledge. So yes, you get these emergent properties, but it's only a result of our ignorance and lack of cleverness or something like that. I think that's fundamentally true, and that touches on the question of chance. So let me give two examples. Let's forget about all modern physics. Let's go back to Newton. Let's assume his nice clockwork universe with pendulums and things like that all apply. So we'll go back to them. Even in that world, if you do something as simple, you can have a pendulum swinging like that. If you're doing A-level mathematics or physics, you can write down the equation, solve them, you can predict that motion absolutely perfectly. Do something as simple as put that pendulum over a magnet just on the floor underneath it. What you find then is that the motion becomes what's called chaotic, even in a simple system like that, and that even though all the laws are entirely deterministic, the behaviour is unpredictable and chaotic. You cannot predict the behaviour of that. The only way to find out what happens is to go, well, it doesn't mean it's random, there are limits on where it can go, but the precise pattern of the motion isn't predictable. In other words, you can have deterministic laws which give rise to chaotic and, in a sense, probabilistic, statistical type behaviour. That's the whole what's called chaos theory. I could bore you for hours on this subject, but it's really important to understand. Somebody said, can you have both at the same time? Yes, that's what chaos theory says. You can have determinism, which in a sense gives rise to chaotic, unpredictable behaviour at the same time. And that's in simple Newtonian dynamics, before you ever get to any modern science. So, and that's not a result of ignorance. If you have chaotic behaviour in those simple systems, it's not that we're not clever enough to predict the motion. You can show very rigorously and mathematically that in principle it's not possible to predict exactly where the motions go. And the only way really to find out is to go along for the ride, to put it crudely. So it's important to understand that that's fundamental and not simply a result of our ignorance. And that's even more true, I'd argue with spades on, when it comes to this idea of emergent properties. If people ask for examples, read the work of Ilya Prigogine. He wrote a very good book called Order Out of Chaos, which is, it's not you know, too difficult to understand as long as you've got some familiarity with science, where he looks at this. Up until then, the science of thermodynamics, because of the difficulties involved with it, what they'd looked at is systems which were essentially at or near what's called equilibrium. In other words, they didn't have big heat exchanges with other things, isolated systems to a degree. And then you can develop lots of nice laws of thermodynamics and do this. What he came along and said, look, that's not how most things behave in the real world. Most things are open. Think of your body. You're constantly exchanging heat and stuff with the world outside you. The real world is like that. As soon as you start looking at that, what he went on to look at, you get all sorts of behaviours and ways of happening that you simply cannot predict and explain at all from the underlying laws. You have to begin to understand them at a different level. I say this is not fantasy or hand waving. It's not a result of ignorance or lack of computing power. What these people have demonstrated is that you get genuinely novel, genuinely new ways of behaving, which in principle are not reducible to the laws before. They make this thing quite mathematically rigorous. So it's not just this thing that, oh, if we had a bigger computer, or if we were a bit more clever. In fact, the opposite. What they're arguing and proving is that this idea of an emergent properties, which can't contradict the underlying laws, but equally is not reducible ever in principle to be explained simply on the basis of those underlying laws, that there's genuine novelty, which has to be understood at its own level, is built into the natural world in a physical physical sense in biology. I mean, John will correct me how valid it is, but the work in America from somebody like Stuart Kaufman, I think, is quite interesting. But again, he looks at the same idea, that you can get, at certain levels of biology, new laws, new ways of behaving, which are genuinely novel and simply can't be reduced down to the level below. And in all areas of science, there's lots of work being done on this. I said that's there's a very good book called just called Complexity, which is quite a popular book. And I say Order Out of Chaos by Ilya Prigogine is another one, which begin to give you an insight into this. And what I want to insist on is that this is not some philosophical or weird thing. This is working scientists, people who got Nobel Prizes and things like that, who are now beginning to discover that they can be precisely trace how in our understanding of the natural world, how out of underlying behaviour, at certain levels of complexity, they can trace precisely the process by whether new and novel things get thrown up, which can be understood and scientifically explained, but they also be understood in a different way and not simply collapse down to the level below. For me, that's fantastically exciting, and George is absolutely right. You don't have to be a Marxist to do scientist. I'm sorry to tell you, some of the most brilliant scientists in history have been reactionary swines, even a few Nazis among them, if truth be told. Politics is not a precondition for being a good scientist. But what is quite interesting is many of the scientists involved in this work suddenly find themselves saying things like, oh, there's a bit of a parallel between this and some of the ideas that I read about. I mean, Ilya Prigogine's an example. He ends his book by saying, the more I do this, the more I notice there's a strange parallel between this and the kind of thing that Engels was talking about 100. Now, that doesn't mean Engels predicted any of this, but it's an interesting convergence, that idea that you have to understand the emergence of different levels of behaviour and how they have to be understood at their own level, drives people towards a more dialectical, if you want, understanding of the natural world. So if people are interested in these debates, there are many good popular books you can go which begin to give you the thing. But the only word of caution is don't assume common sense. Common sense is very helpful. Common sense is not a substitute for serious thinking and serious science, especially when common sense goes outside of the four walls of this room and starts venturing into either other levels of nature, either out there in the universe or down there in the micro world or in biology. You have to think, understand, find out things, and then try our best as our possible to create theories which explain them. But in my view, don't ever expect we'll ever have a tablet of stone, there's the theory of everything with a little equation on that tells you everything. That's a fantasy and isn't science, in my opinion.